Hello, good afternoon. This is one of the very few non-technical sessions, so you will not see any code whatsoever. Some time ago, I finished my education in counseling regarding psychology, so technically I'm a doctor. So not the kind that can cut you open, but more the kind that will sit next to you when you're having a heart attack and will ask you how you feel about it. So that's the kind of doctor I am. Depends on what your illness is.
When you have a heart
attack. Yeah, then I'm not the guy. So my thesis was about influencing both individuals and people in changing an organization. So that's very abstract. But DevOps is, in a way, changing not only the way you work, but the way 9 out of 10 times an entire company works. Mostly it comes down to communication, but 9 out of 10 times, isn't that always the problem? So I'll try to give you some help in selecting, finding the right team members to avoid many of those problems. And if you have them, I'll give you some tips to still get done what you want. So where to start? Crazy enough, you start at the end. So you begin with visualizing what do you want to achieve, what do you want to gain. So if you're having a product, you kind of want to have the product stable, right? A clean, nice solution, stable, you can depend on. You don't have to fix all the time because you wrote crappy code. On the other hand, that's what you want. Who's using the product? What do they want? And your employer, he pays you. What does he want? So that's all stakeholders, including yourself, you have to take into account. All of them have different demands, different requirements, needs, etc. So first, you define all of those. And in my experience, 9 out of 10 times companies have a mission, vision, strategy, and it's on the website, it's a few rules of blah, 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 blah. But now also, you can deduce from their mission or vision, what you as a team have as a mission, vision, strategy. So currently I'm working at a company that does a lot of things, but one of the primary goals is Volkswagen in the Netherlands. So, and also Porsche and Audi, and they refuse to give me a nice car. But one of the things there is that they have a mission, vision, strategy. It is delivering excellence to our customers. Okay, nice. Now what? So if we apply that same thing to our team, how do we deliver excellence to our customers? Because our customers are not the end users. Our customers are the people running servers in the cloud, in the data center. We do infrastructure. So that's something to think about for your own team. Once that's clear, the rest falls into place. What are your principles? And I'll get back to those. So your customers, what technologies do you use? The technical roles. Do you only have developers? Do you have DevOps? So maybe also operational person? Do you have a team of operations, a team of developers, multiple team of developers maybe, and do they communicate? Do you have one team where all are represented? There's all different flavors of implementation. So, principles. Yeah, I'll get back to that. Getting management to buy in. That nine. Who gets management buy-in for writing scripts? Nice. Okay, who gets management buy-in for writing tests? A few less hands. Okay. That's pretty awesome, because 9 out of 10 times, that's the first wall you walk into. Sorry, I'm not spending any of my budget on that. You're an operational team. You need to keep operations going. Easy peasy. That's all you need to do. The problem is taking the time. If you work harder, if you work more efficient, etc., that's all nice. But if you don't take the time to learn new technologies, new skills, etc., in your own time, on the working hours, I don't care. You will never get management buy-in. Because who gets hours, even weeks maybe, during business hours to learn, to train? About 10 people, you are lucky. You're really lucky. Because so far I've only been at 2 customers where they say, sure. Most of the customers say, hey, we can deliver you the content, but learning the knowledge, that's something you do in your own time. We pay for it, and the rest is an investment from your side. So the evenings, the weekends, etc. And that, to be blunt, IT people, really passionate people in IT, they do it anyway. And that's what a lot of managers know. They use it. So hey, we give you the facilities, we sit back and watch you spend your weekends. But if you do that, then you can show, hey, I've got some little thing in PowerShell. How many domain admins do you have? 2 minutes later, you know. How many users have access to a certain directory? Hour later, you know, etc. And without any extra additional tooling. So not even how many, but which users. That's operational tasks I got asked by project leaders quite a lot. Like which people have access to a certain directory. One fun thing in the government in the Netherlands, they paid a lot of money for a converter for converting Office 2007 documents, DOC, to DOCX documents. Apparently what the thing did was change the file extension. You're laughing, but it cost them tens of thousands of euros. So I got hired to do a scan of the environment based on the first bunch of characters, which is an identifier of what type of file it is. So I'm looking for DOCX files that have a header consistent with DOC files. That's a lot of files I go back. And then they were like, hey, that's impossible. We had that tool. We ran that tool. We have a log over here. The file you're saying is inconsistent. Our tool says it has been converted, so not possible. And then we did an investigation and found out that, wait a sec, something has gone wrong here. And one of the developers was like, okay, let's decompile that thing. So he decompiled it. He looked into the code and he was like, what? So that's one of the reasons, one of the things you can eventually, by gaining the knowledge, you can help your company and get in something of a leading position. Lead by example. Quite fast, people will know, hey, that guy. If I ask it to the service desk, sure, they will give me the answer sometime. But if I ask him specifically, he does it for me. And in the background, I'll fill in the ticket and he can say that, hey, I spent so many hours, etc. But I ask him. 5 minutes later, I put in the tickets. 5 minutes later, I got my answer. Great. And they'll come back to you. And again, and again, and again. The problem is they're bypassing the entire process of ticketing systems. Does that never happen at your company? So if you know it happens, use it. Do you? Not a question mark, just do you. As a team, as a customer, as a company, sure, look at your competitors, but don't try to emulate them. If you want to be in a leading position, you have to be the freaking first. There is nobody to emulate. On the other hand, you can learn by looking at your competitors. For example, the two or three, I don't know where you work, but the guys from Coolblue, you do some really great stuff on continuous integration. So how awesome would that be to just look in your environment? Not do a copy paste, but maybe a few screenshots. And you guys, I believe, do a lot of this content you post online for the community. So we can learn from them. That's the next step. If you're ahead of everybody else and you share that with the world, people will notice, hey, you are doing cool stuff. I want to join your team. So these are a few principles. In my experience, if you stand by these, you will have the trust of your customers, but also the trust of your colleagues. Because standing by these things will allow you to facilitate teamwork. I don't know who said that, but teamwork is a little bit like a marriage. The sum of the parts need to be, the whole needs to be more than the sum of the parts. So 1 + 1 = 3, and not that there's a baby on the way, but I'll get back to that because this is the one thing I see going wrong, and not only by managers. Because who here works at a company with more than 10 IT people? Nice. So, think about all your colleagues. Who can think of a person that is quite dominant? It's always his way. Not more? Okay. Also not your manager? Or your director, maybe? Because, hey, it's his company, right? So, the problem is that Steve Jobs said that. Why hire smart people if to tell them what to do? Hire smart people to tell you what to do. Because you hire them for their intelligence, their expertise. So this is the number one sin I see. Shut up. I don't need your input. If I want your opinion, I'll give it to you. Yeah, ego is 9 out of 10 times comes into play. In in psychology, there are two mainstreams. You've got the who knows Freud? Ever heard of the guy? Of Carl Jung? Okay, Carl Jung was the somewhat of the apprentice of Freud, but Freud basically said a human has a certain behavior. When you clean the slate, there's nothing left. There's no don't touch the fire because it burns. Doesn't know it, doesn't understand it, has to experience it to gain the knowledge. Jung said a little bit differently. There is already knowledge in the human present through genetics, through, he doesn't know, but it is there. So Freud's thing, that clean slate, is called tabula rasa. Basically means clean slate. As far as I know, doesn't exist. Because building a team, you've got just like an environment, you've got a greenfield. Ever heard of the phrase? That's like awesome. No legacy crap. And that's you've got brownfield. You're laughing, but it's greenfield is a phrase from agriculture, also brownfield. So I did my Wikipedia, come on. Brownfield basically means you already have something that's present and you have to work with what you got. You can get new resources into play, sure, but additional. That means that the people already have certain experiences. There is ego. There is maybe some resentment every now and then. Because have you never heard from the networking guys, for example, that or the other way around, the Windows guys, it's networking again. Or even the picture, the moment when you prove it's a networking issue. Thank you. That's a part of the reason why technically it's always brownfield. There's always something present. Based on past experiences, you hate networking guys because they always fuck up. In your experience, maybe. You're at a new company, new team, new people, maybe. That networking guy, girl, doesn't need to be the same way. You don't know yet. Innocent until proven guilty. Yeah. So, next to that, why is it always the technologist that has to learn to speak management and not the management that needs to learn to speak technologist? Because hey, it's easier for a technologist to become a manager management function than the other way around, because that never happens. So, yeah, that's another one of the things I noticed over the years. What? Oh, yeah, hi. Yeah, automation. I hear a lot of people say, yeah, automation equals scripting. No, it doesn't. Ever heard of System Center? Ever heard of Chef? Ever heard of any other product you can click? 9 out of 10 times there's a workflow behind it for stuff to automate. If it's OS deployment or application deployment, it's some form of automation. Downside is you're limited to what the developer has offered you in that product. The benefit about scripting, or even with products that have APIs you can use, is that you can link things together. Make your own orchestration, your own flow, your own runbook. Scripting? Yeah, we're going to do scripting. We're using PowerShell. Why? Because it's awesome. Great, we run 80% Linux servers, 10% Apple devices, and 10% Windows. Why use PowerShell? Because it's awesome. Okay, next. The team you have currently are mostly Linux focused. They don't know PowerShell. What they do know is Perl, Bash, Ansible. Because PowerShell is awesome? That's the OPEX, CAPEX discussion. A lot of people, one customer I'm, the customer I'm currently at, they initially went to the cloud. Why? Thank you! But that's exactly the answer I got. And yeah, why do you want to go to the cloud? Because it's awesome, because it's cool, because it's hype, because everybody does it. Because, no, give me a good, solid reason. What does it benefit the business? Well, it's scalable. Sure. It's cost it's cost effective. Well, what you're proposing is moving 300 of our 1,000 servers into infrastructure as a service. Like one-on-one migration to the cloud. Trust me, that will not be cost effective. The reason, by the way, the customer is running Windows Server 2003 servers. And Azure doesn't support that anymore, but AWS does. You can run it on it. The problem is that if you have a leak, Microsoft ain't fixing it. So that's something to keep in mind. The downside, management has decided not to invest in the current data centers anymore. No new hardware, no new software at all. The only thing they do is extend support. Maybe. You have to really make a case for them to invest millions, as they did in Service 2003. The newest hardware we have was bought in the end of 2015. That's the newest hardware we have. That means that at latest, including extended support, we have to migrate, shut down the data center at the end of 2019. And currently, with the philosophy, there's no exit strategy. We're doing it. So we made an inventory of those 2003 servers. Just to begin, let's start with the most problematic stuff. How much of it is business critical? Guess at the answer. All of it, sure. So are we going to upgrade? Yeah, we're going to upgrade. Why haven't you done it before? Because the vendor is bankrupt. Okay, because the bankrupt, or it is an own application, they just developed it one time, it does its function and don't touch it. And if it breaks, yeah, I hope you created a snapshot. Situation with all that. And that's kind of problematic. So here it comes down to communication again, and not between dev and ops, but between IT and the business. Because in this case, the business needs to pay budgeting for the application migrations. Perhaps buying a new application. Maybe phasing two applications into one. They need to pay for it. They're the stakeholder. DevOps. Will Anderson, is he in the room? Willie? No. Die. Will has made a quote about DevOps, and I think it's pretty accurate, actually. The problem is, this is how I see it in traditional... He was expecting this, by the way. All the phones are going up. This is what I see at traditional companies where IT is going DevOps and we're doing Agile. They tried it at my current customer before I came in. They lasted 2 months doing Scrum. It doesn't work because they do exactly Scrum in 1 week, go. It's an operational team. So let's plan the server to break, okay? In 2 weeks, then we have time, not before. You feel a problem here coming? I don't know. Maybe. So, if you do this, make alliances, build armies, and it is us versus networking. Always fun. Oh, by the way, make alliances. If you get security behind you, you're set. They will kick open doors, they will have budget, anything is possible. If only, where do you work? I want to help you. Oh, they don't cooperate. Yeah, where are the penetration testing and testing guys? Are they here? Next to that, there are some tools from Microsoft, AWS, also online, health tests written in PowerShell. You can run on your environment, on XenApp, on Citrix, on Active Directory, etc. And 9 out of 10 times, there will be some security recommendations. One or two. At a small investment bank, a private bank, I was in the Netherlands. They had an audit from KPMG. And the report had a nickname, 50 Shades of Red. Yeah. So 9 out of 10 times, there will be some things they will find. So recruitment, that's another thing. That's my fun part. Recruit on behavior, not personality. Personality is who you are. It is a heck of a job to change who you are. It takes years. Behavior is easy. Let's take, for example, I'm not religious. I was raised in a certain way. So I learned from my peers to use certain curse words. It's learned behavior. But I'm on a customer that's highly religious. I can't throw out a certain phrase there. So I have to put a filter on or whatever, not to do that. And what I noticed that after working there a year, I left and I stopped using the word. I don't use it at all anymore. It doesn't even come into my mind to use it. That's behavior you can change. That's easy. And yeah, I was forced to change it. You cannot force your colleagues. Sure you can. That's the fun part. you can quote me on this, but people are like dogs. Some you can command, like a Rottweiler. A Rottweiler, you go, sit, and it will sit. They've got a Tibetan Mastiff, Mastino. That's a dog of 85 kilos. It's a big dog. It's like a Danish dog, but with a mass. And if you do, sit, it will look at you and like, what you gonna do? So you have to appease him, make it interesting for him to sit. Maybe if he learns that if he sits, he gets a cookie. You know Big Bang Theory? Yeah? Everybody who knows? Yeah. Ah, good audience. You know the episode where Sheldon uses chocolate to change Penny? Sure you can use things to influence your colleagues. The problem is, it is technically manipulation. And the problem, manipulation in itself isn't bad. The reason why people have a negative feeling with the word manipulation is because I want you to do something which benefits me. So I manipulate you into doing that. And I'm like, ha, thank you, bye. And you've done all the job. All the work. Now what? But if I know something that if you do this, if you change a certain behavior, we all benefit, specifically also you, not even necessarily me, I'm an external guy, I don't care, then you will do stuff, you will change things, and you notice that, hey, this benefits me. If you don't notice, it's my job to make you notice. That's technically a job of the manager, I'll get back to that. So, recruit on intelligence, not knowledge. Knowledge you can gain, experience you can gain. Intelligence is there. You can train it a little, but technically, it's pretty sad. And Einstein said, stupidity has its limitations. Oh, sorry, intelligence has its limitations. Stupidity has no such limitation. And recruit on passion, not ambition. Ambition. Let's say ambition. I want to become the CTO. My passion. I like to automate, help you do awesome stuff for our customers. That's passion. Becoming a CTO is not circumstantial. It's a maybe a result of. Maybe. Doesn't need to be. Just do what you like. The rest will follow. That never happens to me. You don't recognize that? Not from yourself or from others? I do all the work and I don't see the benefits. Why not? Do people see you do that? Because a lot of people do awesome stuff. I know in the Netherlands, a lot of people, like, look, I'm an MVP, but in the Netherlands, there are people way more proficient in PowerShell than I am. But then they're not public about it. They don't share it. How does Microsoft need to know? They can't. So that's one of the reasons, share it. And then there may be a result, doesn't need to be. And as long as you do what your passion is, you can keep at it like for years. You like it, you love it. And if your ambition is to become an MVP and you work really hard for 3 years and you're still not an MVP, are you gonna keep it up for another 3 years? If it's not your passion, probably not. So, a recruitment gotcha. Recruitment, you're gonna hire people with the skills, right? Well, if you're recruiting for intelligence, not knowledge, not the skill yet, why only limit to those who already have the skill? To be blunt, they're expensive. So if you combine them, persons with the skills, persons that maybe a rookie. It doesn't matter if you're a rookie. Toward an end customer, never show it that you're a rookie. Because, I'm sorry, but if I'm paying 100 euros an hour and you send me a rookie, why am I paying 100 euros an hour? I'm not paying for his education. That's what customers will say. And if you come over as in a certain way, well, let's take example, I'm a dominant person. Not even dominant, when I walk in, I'm there. Oh, sorry. I'll get back to that in a few. Come on. Metrics, let's start with that. I'll walk in a few minutes again. There are many different tests. Tests of what your character is. Are you dominant? Are you red? Are you blah, 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 blah. What I want to test is your behavior. And technically, there are three different kinds of behavior. There's your core, there's your second layer, first layer of behavior, and second. The second one is what you see. You see me present, stand in front of here. My core behavior is that I'm scared shitless. When I started presenting, the first 5, even 7 years after a session, you could grab my t-shirt and... Okay. So, I learned myself to, hey, this is a bunch of people. If I've got 2 people, I've got 50 people, 500 people, I don't care anymore. Actually, a group of 500 is easier for me because your face goes up in a mass of people. I don't see your face. 9 out of 10 times, there's a spotlight on my head. Trust me, I don't see you. I see a shapish person there. And then I look at maybe you, but maybe the person next to you, and maybe there, and you don't know. Only when I say, hey, you, with the arms over each other and the watch, then you know who. Perhaps, maybe the person behind you, you don't see that. So that's all things you can learn yourself to overcome your weaknesses. Tests that test behavior also show you your weakness. Weakness based on your behavior. And because behavior is something you can change your weakness. Not necessarily make your weakness into a strength, but slim the weakness a little bit down. Not make it your biggest weakness anymore. And don't try to remove the weakness. It is a part of you, actually. And the same thing with cursing words. Technically, people cannot teach themselves not to make a remark, a phrase, when they hit on their thumb with a hammer. Ow, probably, but 9 out of 10 times something comes along with that. So there's always a word there. What you can do is teach yourself to say another word. A word that has nothing to do with religious, isn't discriminating, etc. So pick a word. Teacup. Teacup, speaker, beamer, whatever. A word, whatever word, could work. So if you try to remove all your weaknesses, what you will notice is, hey, you've got a few spikes. Over there, I've got an anchor, 9. Great. Let's pull it back to a 5. And what you will see probably is the 4 in the helper corner becoming a 6. Nine out of 10 times, if you remove something here, on the opposite end, something will... Action, reaction, equal, or even worse. Remember that, because one of these 4 is me. Any guesses? All of them the other time? No. Well, these tests were made by people in the same month. So, not by me. Just one by me. And actually, I'm this. Yeah, apparently. I was surprised too. But what you see? I've got a 3 over here. Apparently, I'm not so much of an anchor. Okay. So, I can see that as perhaps my weakness. Let's make that 3 into a 5. Then this 5 probably goes down to a 4. So, I'm not a pioneer anymore. Well, I've got my own company. I kind of want to be a pioneer. But I also want to be anchor, right? So do I have to choose? Pretty much, yeah. So, and this is where a team comes in. If you've got a person that does this, one that does this, one that does this, you probably get something over here. As a whole, you function. The sum of the parts, etc. The Borg? Well, actually, I will so get back to you on that. So, stay true to yourself. This is something I posted earlier this week on Facebook. For example, I'm at a customer sometimes for in a management meeting where I have to be in a techie role. I'm looked at as a deep technical specialist, blah, 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 blah. So I'm probably going in t-shirts like this. To a management meeting? Serious? Yeah. I'm in a technical role there, right? 9 out of 10 times, some managers, you have to do your background checks on those people, but they expect some stereotype of a technical person. Use that stereotype. It's awesome. The moment you walk in, you are the specialist. The problem, I found it out the hard way when I was still employed by a project company. Albert, he was the really senior, really good technical guy, architect. An architect who could actually build stuff, that's also useful. But we walked in, he in a suit and a tie and a... and me in something like this, la 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 la, backpack on my back. And we walk in and people were like, hey, you, Jeff, hi. So how are you going to build this? And I'm like, I don't know. They thought he was the sales guy, the account manager. Stereotype. So if you know those people are used to those stereotypes, you can use that. That's again behavior. Technically, this is manipulation. You are using their stereotypes in their head to your advantage. So if you're more the junior guy, or even if you're together, I'm from company A, he's from company B, we both want to get this job, and you know this guy's behavior. He looks into a stereotype. He looks for a techie. He already has the project manager, has the project leader, the business consultant. He wants a techie. I'm gonna win, trust me. Because I've done my homework. By the way, LinkedIn, awesome. With recruitment, even if you have a team, bye-bye. I'm sorry, you don't fit. You don't fit anymore. You won't fit if you're still building a team. Dare to say bye. You don't have to kick him out. That's the other side of the coin. But maybe within that team, he doesn't fit. Let's say, for example, that he's extremely dominant. You've got a bunch of people that's more like, well, we're modest, we do our thing, you tell us what to do, we do it excellent. But we're quiet about it. We don't need to be in the spotlight. And there's one guy that's like, yahoo! And he's taking all the energy. The rest of the team, that's probably introverts, will get drained by that guy. He will suck up all the energy. And every time they go home, they're exhausted. And they have no idea why. They do exactly the same thing. There's one thing different. That guy joined the team. That's it. And he may be technically very good. And they don't need to teach him anything whatsoever. But still, they go home. They're exhausted. Now, 1 week, no problem. 2 weeks, no problem. 3 months, they're like, I have to go to work again. And that's how you break a team. So, How much time do I have? Yeah, getting good for that. That's now. So, Kolb was a psychology dude, teacher. He was, okay, let's look at how people learn. Learning has four phases. You experience something or you feel something. You reflect or watch, whatever. You do an abstract conceptualization or think. So you work through what you just saw, you deduce. And based on that, you draw your conclusions and you experiment. So, experiencing something, or basically learning something, you can go start here in any phase you like. For example, learning to use a new software application. You probably start here. Yes? Why? Don't you read the help? No? Then you're probably not so much of an abstract conceptualization person. Riding a bicycle. First you watch. You watch and you, oh, cool. So they're doing this and 1, 2, 3. Okay, let's try. 1, 2, bonk. Oops. Hey, you fell. You experienced. Wait a sec. Let's think back about that. I did this. Then I fell. Oh, let's don't do that last step. So these are the basic steps. Who said that about the board? So, this is how people learn, which is extremely useful when you start building a new team that has no knowledge yet about a product. The customer I met, we're building two teams, one for Azure, one for AWS. Both teams have no experience with the product, but they are going to build the services in those platforms. They're going to manage it, the operations. They have no clue yet. Luckily, there's no production running yet. So knowing how they learn is very important. Because if they're an abstract guy, I want to give them documentation, architectural pictures, etc. If they're an experiment do person, give them a playground. Give them a subscription of 100 euros a month or whatever and go. Build. Try. Break stuff. Break stuff in your own subscription, please. So, playing the victim, who knows somebody in their work, in their private life, like, boo, the world is out to get me. The same with, hey guys, the portal is down. Yeah, you're part of the team that manages the portal. Yeah, it's down. Hint. You're part of the team that manages the freaking thing. So, yeah. Yeah. What? Well, that's the thing. long time ago, even before DevOps became a thing in the operations world, but I was at a hosting provider. No, they're not sitting in the room. Too bad. I put in a ticket for a customer, and it was a storage question, I believe. And I was like, it's been 2 weeks. The customer still doesn't have it. It was like a LAN of 200 gigabytes. That's it. Okay. I'm walking to the service desk. Hey, yeah, I'm kind of new here, just a month. The customer asked for this and this. I see in the ticket that you made an internal note. I emailed Gijs. 3 days later, I've emailed Gijs. 5 days later, I've emailed Gijs. Yeah, who's Gijs? Yeah, that guy. He is sitting next to you! Yeah, but if I email him, it's not my responsibility anymore. I don't have to talk to him. Come on. I send him an email. And by email, it is locked, so I've done my job. Not my responsibility. I don't do storage. I do ticketing. That's what I get sometimes. You never? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, educate them. And with educate, I mean... So, walking into the room. Every now and then, there's a person that's like, hello! And they're like... The problem is that every now and then, somebody walks in and he's like an elephant in a room filled with glasses. He's like, la, 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 and everything goes wrong. The problem is let's say it's an external consultant that has blah, 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 blah. He says things and you're like, that's not gonna work. That never happens. Not with you, because I'm speaking from experience here. I've been both on that side and I've been the consultant, so... But also people coming from school, they came from school, they have the latest knowledge, they are going to make it, they have got the awesome job. They come in and they're like, woohoo! Because experienced people don't see it like Miley Cyrus on a ball. They will see Ron Jeremy and they're like, oh dude, come on! So that's also a thing. Know how you come over to other people, to your customers. Like I said, I'm going to a meeting sometimes in a geeky shirt. There's no place like 127.0.0.1, for example, or whatever. This one I got from my girlfriend because, hey, I became a doctor. She liked it. So know what kind of effect it will have. So Dr. Meredith Belbin, that was an American lady who described what kind of flavors of people are generally in a team. Please. There's a bunch of text, but what I want to shout out here is that each of them have a downside. The first line is the positive thing. The second line is the downside, the negative thing. It can be inflexible. They don't need to be. Their core behavior is inflexible. But they have perhaps learned skills, learned to behave differently, and that's why they don't come over as inflexible. Their core behavior is still that. So because when they're angry or when they're hungry or stuff like that, that's fun. When you're hungry, your core behavior comes out to play. Ever heard the term hangry? for those who don't know, it's getting hungry when you getting angry when you're hungry. So these are roles based on action. Those are the doers. These are people-oriented. Team leads, scrum masters, recruiters. Scrum masters not per se. They can also be, no. The process needs to be followed. Those people are ideal for process management. Because when you break the process, they will get quite upset. And then, I forgot to change the people thing. Well, action, people, and don't remember anymore. I believe technical stuff. Inflexible people. What if I'm a person that is extremely flexible, adaptable? Something happens and, hey, sure, you give me a rule, I will find a way around it. Those are very good people of testing processes. For example, have you ever heard about the Surface table from Microsoft? You know, the table thingy that was a computer? It was basically a table with the characteristics of a computer. Because the idea was you set that thing in between and people get around it and they work together. I tried it once. But they were finished. They created the software for it. They were done. They sent that thing to an elementary school. You know, so with the little Muppets there. And apparently, the analysis got a game called Scrabble. You know that with the letters and you need to make words, etc. Yeah. One child was standing on this side of the table, one on that side of the table, and they were letter war. Because they forgot to set the boundaries of the board. The game was in the middle of the table, of the board. Outside of the board was still screen. Still touchable screen, workable screen. So they got a letter and from the board and they had a war. They were technically hacking. They were abusing, better yet, they were using something not in the way it was intended. That's technically the definition of hacking. Everybody were hacking things about cracking and freaking, etc., and passwords, etc. Hacking itself comes very basic down to using stuff in a way it was not intended. So the manager, that's his one single function, purpose, role. According to her, only when regards to the team. A team member make sure you represent your part of the team, your part of the whole. So that's why for recruiting a solid team, you need to define, hey, where do I want my team to be in, for example, that chart. Thank you. So I want my team to have these characteristics. Just draw it out. Not even having talked to a single person. Then talk to the people. Hey, do I like you? That's also a thing. Do I think you have the skills? Do I think you have the intelligence? If you don't have the skill, the intelligence is more important. Do you have the passion, etc.? Then combine, let them make a test. Behavior. Do they comply? And etc. together, then multiple of those tests on top of each other, and you get a pretty much idea of what you want. I've done it multiple times, it works. one function where this Belbin stuff does not work. Ever. Managers. That's what a different psychologist found out. This does not apply to managers. If you have a large enterprise and you have like 10 managers that together are a team above 100 different teams, this methodology does not apply. That's why there's another psychologist made a different model for them. Oh, just a warning, if you ever dive into this stuff, there are hundreds of models. This one is one of the base models. Most of them are derived from this one. So, when your team is ready, let's start scripting, automating, DevOpsing, or whatever you want to call it. So, define the services you're going to offer. You break those up into features, components, tasks. Tasks you can actually work on. Because if you work on a feature, how long will that take? More than 2 weeks? 4 weeks a sprint? Probably. But if you break them down into workable, eatable tasks, eatable parts, you can do this. And automate is a way of, is a means to an end. I think you should, because else you will need a lot of people. So, writing tests, if you don't get management approval or whatever, I don't need tests. Tests do not bring us anything. You write code, code does something, and that's useful. That brings us something. Test? Nah, your code works without the test. You tested it, right? You ran it, it worked. Ah, great. This time already? Oh, okay. Okay, then no code delivery without a app. So when I did some investigation for my thesis, Bushido, you know the way of the samurai? It has 9, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 base concepts that come down to this. And if you remember one of my first slides, I had some principles there. Most of them pretty much come down to the same thing. So these principles you can depend on. It's proven. Because the samurai were the elite fighting force on the planet for at least 1,000 years. So they did something right. Okay. Don't have time for that anymore. But basically, if you have pen and paper, this is an exercise I always do for people to dare to take ownership of what you deliver. Take a paper. Draw the person sitting next to you. You get 60 seconds. Go. Yeah, 45 seconds, 30 seconds, 20, 10, go, go, pens down. And then you get a drawing, and people are like, because they have to show the drawing to the person they draw. And they're like, yeah, sorry. Why sorry? Seriously, why sorry? I gave you 60 seconds. You can't do a masterpiece in 60 seconds. No way. So if you get a limitation for within your task, let's say from a manager or project manager, because now we promised the customer, we have to deliver. No, okay, never happens. This is what I delivered. I'm proud of it. Because if you give the same exercise in an elementary school, which one of you has kids? Which one of you have kids that bring drawings home? And they're like, look, daddy, mommy, what I've done. Woohoo! They're proud of it. And you're like, Yeah, on the refrigerator. So that's something also you need to teach them. If you have certain boundaries you can't exceed, that's all you're going to deliver. You've done your best. More you can't do within the boundaries set. If they want better, give me wider boundaries. And throughout the process, throughout recruitment, throughout working in a team, adjust your strategy based on observations of people's emotional reactions to certain points. Specifically, if they get a feeling like, I'm going to work again, you're actually already too late. Because that's why they leave. And some people leave faster than others. Some people are very loyal. But it comes down to this. And practically, I know don't know if you know the phrase, technologists don't leave companies because of the work, but because of managers or direct colleagues. If you're going to work not feeling, yay, I'm going to work, I'm going to do my passion, why should you want to go? It's 8 hours, excluding getting there and getting back, of your day. So the recruitment phrases I had, those three, recruit for blah instead of blah, you can look at that. That's the one thing I want to give back to you. If you do the recruitment of the team correctly, communication, DevOpsing, automation will be a result. Don't aim for that. Keep that as a goal. But there are a lot of more steps in between you need to take to get there. If you don't take them, you will fail. That's the end.